This is LBC from Global, leading Britain's conversation with Shelagh Fogarty.
Hello there, good afternoon to you. If you're just joining me here at LBC, I want to talk about cladding again and fire safety. The fire safety bill is back in the House of Commons today. The Grenfell United Group say that the government is using the excuse that an amendment from the House of Lords will delay Grenfell recommendations. Grenfell United Group argue that the amendment is to protect leaseholders from charges. And at the same time as this fire safety bill is back in the Commons, Rachael Venables, LBC's correspondent, who's kept such a close eye on this story and the issues that flow from it, has an exclusive report about loans, cladding loans. So let's go straight to Rachael. Bring us up to speed on both of those elements of this story, Rachael, because they're separate but very much connected.
Absolutely, Shelagh. And I think they're two disparate parts of this crisis, which is ongoing and which is growing more and more politically confusing and more politically damaging, I think, for the government as they scramble to try to get a grip of this scandal. I'll start first with the story that we broke on LBC this morning, which is that it could be years, I understand, before the loan scheme to remove flammable cladding from low-rise buildings could be brought in England, with many victims of the crisis fearing bankruptcy in the meantime. Now, these loans were announced by the government just over 11 weeks ago at the start of February. It's their real keystone solution to the crisis for anybody in medium-rise, low-rise buildings below 18 metres who had dangerous cladding. The government was offering up a loan system whereby money would be provided up front to remove the dangerous cladding, and then it would be paid back by individual flat owners or leaseholders over a long term. So these loans, it might take years, decades even, to pay them back, but they'd be capped at £50 a month. And this was something the government was prepared to put billions into, they said, to try and fix the crisis, to protect people from bankruptcy. Now, I should say, first of all, cladding campaigners, leaseholders, you talk to really any of them, they are furious with this suggestion because there are a number of issues. They only cover cladding. This money wouldn't be used to remove, for example, flammable insulation or fix other defects. They'd also be held against the value of the property, many people say. And also there is that key overriding argument at the heart of all of this of whether or not leaseholders should actually have to pay anything. Should they have to pay a single penny to make these buildings safe? Now, the loan system, as I mentioned already, unpopular, but for some people, it is their only hope. It is all that stands between them and financial ruin and bankruptcy, which is why this story is so significant. As I've understood that during a meeting last week between housing officials and cladding campaigners, it was revealed that the government plans to introduce this loan scheme through legislation called the Building Safety Bill. Now, this bill is already long overdue. Many people think it could take at least a year, if not more, to bring it through. And that means, in the meantime, people will be waiting for even that morsel of support. Now, Giles Grover is a campaigner. He was in this meeting and he told me that for some, it's already too late.
We're seeing people across the country that are getting bills right now. People in under 18 metres buildings. One recently got a bill for about £78,000 to be paid within 6 months. We're also seeing managing agents writing on their letters to leaseholders saying, you need to pay these bills because the government hasn't yet actually come forth with details of the loan scheme. So what's really concerning is we asked what the timescales are and they said the plan is to implement it along the Building Safety Bill, which, as we understand it, is going to be a couple of years before that even comes in.
So we've been speaking to a number of people affected by this. As I mentioned, people who aren't happy with loans being their only option, but who are even more unhappy with the thought that they'd have to wait a long time for them to come in. And Zoe lives in a one-bed flat in Chelmsford. Her first baby is actually due in the summer, and she spoke to Nick Ferrari this morning. It is clear she's not sure if she can wait that long for this support.
I mean, it leaves us in a really quite stressful situation. Either our building remains unsafe for years whilst we await for these loans that might come into play, or you know, once the remediation bill lands, I might make bankrupt, and it's one of those two options: either I stay in an unsafe housing for years and years and years while we wait for loans, or I'm financially ruined by a remediation bill that lands before the loans do.
Now, the Ministry of Housing says that these claims are misleading. They say they're working as quickly as possible to launch the scheme and that they'll publish more details in due course. But Shelagh, LBC's report was actually picked up and mentioned in the House of Commons this afternoon by the Shadow Home Office Minister, Sarah Jones, as part of the fire safety debate, which is another key piece of legislation post-Grenfell that the government have been working on. And it also is taking an extraordinary long time to pass.
They don't seem to care that the vague and undefined loan scheme that they've hailed as the answer, despite having promised many times that leaseholders won't have to pay, will damage people's property prices and won't actually be in place, we hear today, for at least 2 years, leaving thousands to pay mountain waking watch bills and stuck in properties they can't sell.
Now, Shelagh, let's turn to properly to the fire safety bill, which you and I have discussed on a number of occasions and which has been on an incredible journey whereby it has bounced between the House of Commons and the House of Lords a number of times now, with Lords continually adding amendments to this piece of legislation, legislation that the government says is really important. They say it will save lives and strengthen regulations post-Grenfell. But the problem is the Lords keep adding amendments which are supported by opposition MPs and a growing number of Tory rebel MPs as well, that would protect leaseholders from having to pay to remove things like flammable cladding from their buildings. And this is a battle which is just going from one side to the other as the bill sort of really starts to struggle. Chris Pincher is one of the ministers from the Department for Housing, and he opened this debate, the fire safety bill debate, which is back in the Commons today, just a little bit earlier, and he really stressed how important it is that it is passed as soon as possible.
If we do not resolve this bill this week, fire risk assessments will not cover those critical elements of which I spoke, and they may continue, therefore, to be ignored by less responsible building owners. Moreover, the fire and rescue services will be without the legal certainty that they need to take enforcement action. Ultimately, that will compromise the safety of many people living in multi-occupied residential buildings.
And the passage of it through the Commons, I mean, it's been complex, but it's been incredibly emotional as well, hasn't it, Rachel? Because, and I want to hear from people about the impact this is having on their lives, because this, for many people, this is life-altering, life-shattering even.
It is. It is a really emotive subject, and you can hear that. I've been listening to the debate started at about 2:30, so I've been listening to some of what the MPs have been saying, and they talk about really emotional, life-shattering sums of money. You've had at these debates before MPs waving pieces of paper which are cladding bills on them, you know, up to, I think one of them was beyond £70,000. We also had one of the Tory MPs, who's actually a sort of Tory rebel in all of this, Royston Smith, the Conservative MP for Southampton Itchen, he took to his feet in the House of Commons earlier, and he talked about how a building in his constituency recently had a fire, and this building has got ACM cladding on it, which is the same as what was on Grenfell. And he talked about how, you know, how would we feel, what would the reaction be if the fire service hadn't on this occasion been able to act, if lives hadn't been saved. And I think that's what's at stake here. It's people's finances, it's their property, but it is also life. This is a building safety crisis at its heart, and what we have are two very conflicting arguments and points of view. The government trying to push this forward, and as I mentioned, rebel Tory MPs, oppositions, and incredibly the House of Lords really saying that they won't allow the legislation to pass easily unless there is this added provision in place that protects leaseholders and their finances.
Thanks, Rachel. Rachael Venables, LBC's correspondent on this. Listening to all of that was Martin Boyd, chair of the Leasehold Knowledge Partnership. Martin, good afternoon to you.
Good afternoon.
In a sea of concerns, what's your priority at this point?
Hopefully the Parliament will support the Lord's amendment. If not, we just continue this ping pong, which is, you know, utterly ridiculous. We've got a government saying 4 years, nearly 4 years after Grenfell, that it's urgent to pass this bill. Well, they should have done something 4 years ago.
And when people look at where the liability for this fire safety is landing, what are your thoughts? What would you say to those who think it's just tough luck?
Well, the problem is, you know, from day one, government has been aware and has repeatedly said that this is not in any way the fault of the people who bought these flats. Mm-hmm. There is no way that you could ever know that you were buying a dangerous flat before Grenfell. And they are also aware that the law makes it almost impossible to sue anyone for the fact that you now live in one of these unsafe buildings. So we have the government saying it's definitely not the fault of the leaseholders and the developers should do the right thing. But instead they're now passing a law which will make sure the exact opposite happens.
So what next then for you and other campaigners?
Well, the fire safety bill will presumably continue to bounce between the Lords and the Commons, and you know normally the accusation is if the Lords continue to press a point that they're being undemocratic. But the reality is, you know, we have everyone from Grenfell United through to Conservative MPs saying this is a bad bill, and the government has just not listened.
And I mean, it has gone back and forth a lot, hasn't it, for attempts at change. Why do you think the government isn't listening, given that it has said, as you've described, people shouldn't be held responsible?
It's difficult to know. I mean, what has been very clear is that at no point have the government sought to engage with anyone about a possible alternative. They've basically just sat in an ivory tower and said, you know, you will agree to this bill or else.
Well, thank you, Martin. I'm sure we'll talk again. Martin Boyd, Chair of the Leasehold Knowledge Partnership. LBC.